السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My respected brothers and sisters, I welcome you all with the words that Abu Sa'id al-Khudri رضي الله عنه would use to welcome his students, marhaban bi wasiyati Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for granting us this opportunity of spending the month of Ramadan with the greatest action after fulfilling one's fara'id, and that is seeking of Islamic knowledge. In Manaqib al-Shafi'i, Imam Bayhaqi rahimahullah, he narrates what is chained to Rabi' ibn Sulaiman. And he quotes from him that he says, سمعت الشافعي يقول ليس بعد أداء الفرائض شيء أفضل من طلب العلم. That after a person completes, Imam Shafi'i rahmallah is saying, after a person completes what is fara'id, there is nothing that is better to. Sorry, is it possible for all of you all to hear from me?
Jim Otis, we hear you.
I see a message here asked to unmute. Is that for someone else?
Jim Otis, you can ignore that, inshallah.
Okay. So Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, he says, ليس بعد أداء الفرائض شيء أفضل من طلب العلم. That there is nothing better after a person completes his fara'id than seeking knowledge. So then his companions asked him, walal jihadu fi sabilillah, not even jihad. So Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah replied and he said, yes, not even jihad. And this is the view of scholars of all four madhahib. Ibn Rajab Hanbali rahimahullah, he says, وَقَدْ نَصَّ الْأَئِمَّةُ الْأَرْبَعَةُ عَلَىٰ أَنَّ طَلَبَ الْعِلْمِ أَفْضَلُ مِنْ صَلَاتِ النَّافِلَةِ. He mentions this in Lataifu al-Ma'arif on page 138. That all four of the imams, they have clearly mentioned that seeking knowledge is better than nafal salam. So yes, whilst we do have numerous statements and incidents of scholars devoting most of the time in Ramadan for reciting the Quran, there are reports from these very same scholars which show that they would still give little time to teaching and studying and writing or even delivering general lectures. So ta'alim and ta'allum is not to be abandoned totally in the month of Ramadan. That yes, we do give more time to reciting the Quran and we actually exert ourselves more in the recitation of the Quran, but with that we still spend time with ilm as well. So alhamdulillah, it is a very great blessing and honor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed us by allowing us to study a book which was held very dear to the greatest of muhaddithin. We find that throughout centuries, many of the senior muhaddithin, they read this book dozens of times. Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, it's mentioned that he read this book to a teacher. He read it to a teacher close to 20 times. So whilst we are excited, we are also overtaken by extreme awe. You know, Imam Malik, rahimahullah, he had an aura of abundant awe, and that has also transferred to his book. Alama Dhahabi, rahimahullah, says, wa inna lil muwaṭṭa la waqa'an fi nufus wa mahabatan fi al-qulub la yuwazinuha shay. That the muwaṭṭa, it has an impact on souls, and it has a reverence and this awe in the heart, la yuwazinuha shay. It is unparalleled. Just 3 points. Since I'm seeing people chatting here. So firstly, please know that I'm holding the phone right by my mouth. So if anyone has to chat, especially if you write down, then I won't even see your chat. So if it's something urgent, then rather say it verbally. And secondly, also, there's a blank screen because there's a difference between an academic lesson and a motivational speech. If it's a motivational speech, you know, you can sit, you can chill, you can relax, and you can listen. But when it is an academic lesson, then you need to set what adab and you need to write, etc. And the third point is that please, even for the future lessons, please do try to attend live. We all have to make sacrifices to attend the live lessons. I myself also have to make sacrifice, but this is nowhere near compared to what the previous scholars had to go through to attain knowledge. So inshallah, we'll commence with the hadith al-awwaliyya. Since most shuyukh, they commence with this narration, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless me with the opportunity of hearing this narration from many, many different shuyukh. And almost all of you may have heard the narration before. There is no need for me to mention a long list of names. Inshallah, in one of the coming lessons, when I mention all my asanid, then you will get an idea of some of the shuyukh who gave me ijazah for this narration. So the very first narration, which many different shuyukh narrated to me with their respective asanid, links to Imam Sufyan ibn Uyayna, and from him, وَإِلَيْهِ يَنْتَهِ التَّسَلْسُلْ بِالْأَوَّلِيَّةِ عَنْ أَمْرِ بْنِ دِنَارٍ عَنْ أَبِي قَامُوسٍ مَوْلَى عَبْدِ اللَّهِ بْنِ عَمْرِ بْنِ الْعَاسِ عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال الراحمون يرحمهم الرحمن تبارك وتعالى ارحموا من في الأرض يرحمكم من في السماء. إن شاء الله, as an introduction, we will discuss about Imam Malik رحمه الله today. And when studying any Islamic book, it is the author's right that we learn about him. Once we learn about him, then we should make it a point to pray for him. We must make dua for all of those who are a means for us to get knowledge. Al-Sheikh Makki ibn Abi Talib al-Qayrawani, he says in the introduction of his book, Al-Kashf an Wujuh al-Qira'at al-Sab'a, he says, فَبَادَرْتُ إِلَىٰ تَأْلِيفِهِ وَنَظْمِي لِيَكُونَ بَاقِيًا عَلَىٰ مُرُورِ الزَّمَانِ وَانْقِرَاضِ الْأَيَّامِ حِرْصًا مِنِّي عَلَىٰ بَقَاءِ أَجْرِهِ وَجَزِيلِ ثَوَابِهِ أسأل الله أن ينفع به مؤلفه والمقتبس العلم منه فواجب على كل ذي مروة وديانة أفاد من كتابنا هذا فائدة أو اقتسب منه علما أو تبين له به معنى مشكل أو علم منه علما لم يكن يعلمه أن يترحم على مؤلفه ومن أتبع سره وبدنه في نظمه واستخراج علله واستنباط فوائده وأن يستغفر لمظهر فوائده ومشهر نوادره وعلومه. So this is the right that we should make dua for those who wrote books and who were a means of conveying a knowledge to us. So then he says, فما علمت أن لشغلي وتعبي بتأليف هذا الكتاب وأشباهه فائدة أعظم من أن يترحم علي من أجله مترحم أو يستغفر لي عند قراءته مستغفر أو يذكرني بخير ذاكر فالرحم الله من بادر إلى ما رغبته فيه من ذكري بالخير والترحم علي والاستغفار لي. So it is in this light that we will also be discussing Imam Malik رحمه الله. And to mention it from a Maliki, so Qadi Iyadh, he narrated from his teacher's teacher, Alama Abu Muhammad al-Tamimi, that he said, يقبح بكم أن تستفيدوا بنا ثم تذكرونا ولا تترحموا علينا. So this lesson is all about fulfilling the rights of Imam Malik rahimahullah. Now this is just an informal lesson. It's a prelude. So it's a mudhakara. The actual academic starts next week, inshallah, when we start with the Muwaṭṭa. But even though this is an informal lesson and we are not going to go into academics, I will try my best, inshallah, to only quote what I know is accurate. And what I know has been transmitted via a chain, or it is mentioned in reliable sources. You know, the greatest commentator of the Muwatta, Alama Ibn Abdul Barr, rahimahullah, he said, أَلَّفَ النَّاسُ فِي فَضَائِلْ مَالِكِ وَأَكْثَرُوا وَأَتَوْا بِمَا لَا فَضِيلَةَ فِي بَعْضِهِ حَشَوْ بِهَا كُتُبَهُمْ فَرَأَيْتُ الْإِقْتِصَارَ مِنْهَا عَلَى عُيُونِهَا أَوْلَى مِنَ الْإِكْثَارِ وَبِاللَّهِ التَّوْفِيقِ. So he's mentioning that many people, they just mention lots and lots of different incidents for Imam Malik rahimahullah and virtues. Many of them are not even authentic. So he says that he will only mention the main points. It's better than rather just mentioning lots of different points. So I am, inshallah, definitely not going to quote the baseless reports that show how immoral Imam Malik rahimahullah was initially and then how he reformed. Sometimes just to sound motivational and to give others hope, people tend to quote this kind of fabrications. But when you have other stronger reports that clearly contradict these types of baseless reports, then you realize that they are all blatant lies. So I'm not going to quote all his lies and fairy tales and unreliable incidents just so that you find the session interesting and captivating. Rather, I'll only mention those points which are authentic. I begin with the narration of Jami'u Tirmidhi. So with my sanad to Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah and all the various ijāzāt that I have to this book, I narrate from Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah that he says, حدثنا الحسن بن الصباح البزار وإسحاق بن موسى الأنصاري قالا حدثنا سفيان بن عيينة عن ابن جريج عن أبي الزبير عن أبي صالح عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنهم رواية يوشك أن يضرب الناس كباد الإبل يطلبون العلم فلا يجدون أحدا أعلم من عالم المدينة وفي رواية لابن حبان فلا يجدون عالما أعلم من عالم المدينة. So Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah and Alama ibn Hibban rahimahullah and others, they narrate this narration that very soon people will beat the flanks of the camels. They will be, it means that they will be traveling in search of knowledge and they will find no one who is more knowledgeable than the scholar of Medina. Now in the printed copies of Jami'u Tirmidhi, after this quotation, the following verdict is mentioned from Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah. That قال أبو عيسى هذا حديث حسن. That he mentioned that this narration is حسن. That means it is suitable, but it's inferior to صحيح. So this is how it is according to the prints of Jami' al-Tirmidhi. That Imam Tirmidhi mentioned and graded it as حسن. But in the manuscript, the verdict is given as حسن صحيح. It's mentioned that Imam Tirmidhi graded this narration as حسن صحيح. And that is why also it's important to check through the manuscripts for the actual gradings of Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah. And Ibn Hibban rahimahullah, he also narrated it in his Sahih, so this shows that this narration is authentic according to him. And this is also the reason why we cannot just trust the gradings of Albani, because he graded this as weak. So then you would assume that this is a weak narration. Meantime, so many earlier experts of hadith, they graded this narration as authentic. Imam Hakim rahimahullah, he also graded this narration as authentic, and he actually said that it's on the caliber of the narrations of Sahih Muslim. He said, "Hada hadithun sahihun ala sharti Muslim." He mentions this in his Mustadrak in the beginning, in volume 1 on page 91. And Alama Zahabi rahimahullah, he also agreed that this narration indeed is on par with the narrations of Sahih Muslim. So Imam Hakim rahimahullah, he explains the reason why some scholars would regard this as weak. He says that وَقَدْ كَانَ ابْنُ عُيَيْنَا رُبَمَا يَجْعَلُهُ رِوَايَةً. So you may have noted when I was quoting it from Tirmidhi that it came at the end that عَنْ أَبِي هُرَيْرَ رِوَايَةً. So we didn't say that قَالَ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. It just is عَنْ أَبِي هُرَيْرَ رِوَايَةً يُشِكُ أَنْ يَضْرِبَ النَّاسَ. So he's not attributing it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he's mentioning it that sometimes when he would quote it like this here. He would merely say, "An Abi Huraira riwayatan." So, but then Imam Hakim rahimullah, he explains. He said, "Walaysa hadha mimma yuhinu al-hadith." That this here, it does not cause the narration to become weak. It's not a valid reason. You looked at student of Fa'in al-Humaydi, huwa al-hakam fi hadithi. The student of Sufyan ibn Uyayna, Humaydi, he is a hakam, he's an extremely reliable person and he knows the narrations of Sufyan ibn Uyayna wa kathrati mulazamatihi lahu. So therefore, this narration will be authentic and it's not a valid reason to grade this narration as weak. Now, after transmitting this narration, Imam Ahmad rahimahullah in his Musnad, he said, وَقَالَ قَوْمٌ هُوَ الْعُمَرِ قَالَ فَقَدْمُهُ مَالِكًا. That some have said that this here refers to Umari, they gave preference to Umari over Imam Malik rahimahullah. And others, they have also mentioned that this narration refers to Imam Malik. So who is Umari? Umari refers to Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah al-Umari. Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah said, وَالْعُمَرِ هُوَ عَبْدُ الْعَزِيزُ بْنُ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ مِنْ وَلَدِهِ عُمَرِ بْنِ الْخَطَّابِ. That it is Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah from the progeny of Umar ibn al-Khattab. So it's transmitted in one report from Sufyan ibn Uyayna that he also assumed that this narration refers to Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah al-Umari. That Ishaq ibn Musa, he says, سَمِعَتُ ibn Uyayna يَقُلْ هُوَ الْعُمَرِ عَبْدُ الْعَزِيزُ بْنُ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ الزَّاهِدِ. That it is Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah the Zahid. However, Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah then quotes another report from Sufyan ibn Uyayna rahimahullah that he said, someone asked him that man alimul Medina, who is this alim of Medina? So he said, innahu Malik ibn Anas. It is Imam Malik rahimahullah. And Imam Hakim rahimahullah, he also quoted that waqad kana ibn Uyayna yaqul nara hadha al-alim Malik ibn Anas. That Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam is saying that people would come to the alim of Medina. This alim of Medina is Imam Malik rahimahullah. So Alama ibn Abdul Bar rahimahullah, he said, qala al-Humaydi qala Sufyan adhunnuhu Malik ibn Anas wa kadhalika rawahu Ibrahim ibn al-Munzir al-Hizami an Sufyan ibn Uyayna. That Imam Sufyan definitely, many times he would say that this year refers to Imam Malik rahimahullah. And thereafter he mentions, he says that this narration is clearly speaking about the alim of Medina, the knowledgeable person in Medina. So Alama ibn Abdul Bar rahimahullah, he says, ليس العمر هذا مما يلحق في العلم والفقه بمالك ابن أنس وإن كان عابدا شريفا. That Abdul Aziz ibn Abdullah, he was known for his worship. He was known for his worship. He was an abid. But in knowledge, he couldn't even come close to Imam Malik rahimahullah. So therefore, the most knowledgeable person. And that is why when mention is made about the scholar of Medina or Imam Dar al-Hijra, then every person's mind immediately goes to Imam Malik rahimahullah. And it was like this year from the very era of Imam Malik rahimahullah. Alama Zahabi rahimahullah, he quotes from Imam Uza'i rahimahullah, وَرُوِيَ عَنِ الْأَوْزَاعِ أَنَّهُ كَانَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ that Imam Malik, Imam Uza'i rahimahullah, when he would make mention of Imam Malik rahimahullah, then he would say عَالِمُ الْمَدِينَ وَمُفْتِ الْحَرَمَيْنِ, that he is the alim of Medina and he's the mufti of the Haramain. Imam Tirmidhi rahimahullah, he also quotes that the great scholar of Yemen had the same view. So he says, وَسَمِعْتُ يَحْيَ بْنَ مُوسَى يَقُولُ قَالَ عَبْدُ الرَّزَاقُ هُوَ مَالِكُ بْنُ أَنَسُ. That Abdul Razak, you know, Abdul Razak, Imam Bukhari rahimahullah, the one regret he had is that he didn't leave the Haramain to travel to Yemen to go and meet Alama Abdul Razak rahimahullah. And thereafter, Alama Abdul Razak passed away. So such a great scholar, he mentioned that this narration refers to Imam Malik rahimahullah. And leave alone the people or the scholars during the time of Imam Malik rahimahullah, even his teachers referred to him as Alimul Madina. And we'll quote about that shortly, inshallah. So from here, we can see that there was Bashara for Imam Malik rahimahullah in the authentic narration from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Imam Malik rahimahullah, his full name is Abu Abdullah Malik ibn Anas ibn Malik. So his father is Anas ibn Malik. He should not be confused with Anas ibn Malik, the Sahabi. Alama Khatabi rahimahullah, Alama Khatiba rahimahullah, he mentions that there were five people who were known by the name Anas ibn Malik. So the first is the famous Sahabi who made the khidmah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The second is another Sahabi who only narrated one narration, and that narration comes in Sunan Abi Dawud and Tirmidhi. The narration is إن الله وضع عن المسافر شطر الصلاة وعن المسافر والحامل والمرضع الصوم أو الصيام. So he only narrated that one narration. So that's the second person with the name Anas ibn Malik. And then the third person with the name Anas ibn Malik is the father of Imam Malik rahimahullah. So these are three main people with this name Anas ibn Malik. Besides these three, there are also two others, but they narrated very little, so you don't even have to consider them. But basically, there were five people who were known as Anas ibn Malik. So Imam Malik rahimahullah, his lineage is Malik ibn Anas ibn Malik ibn Amir ibn Amr ibn al-Harith ibn Ghayman ibn Khuthail. Alama ibn Abdul Bar rahimahullah, he narrates what is sanad to the nephew of Imam Malik rahimahullah, Ismail ibn Abi Uwais, that he mentioned a lineage like the Siyam. In Tazyin al-Mamalik, Alama Suyuti rahimahullah, he cites the lineage all the way back from Imam Malik rahimahullah right up until Ibrahim alayhi salam. So if you're interested, you may refer to page 17 and 18 of the Darul Rashad print of Tazyin al-Mamalik. We won't quote it now. Imam Malik rahimahullah, his family was originally from the Asbahi tribe of Yemen. Qadi ijāzāt rahimahullah, he said, li imami Abi Abdullah Malik ibn Anas al-Himyari thumma al-Asbahi nasab al-Qurashi ثم التيمي بالحلف الحجازي ثم المدني الدار والمولد والنشأة. That his origin was from Asbahi, but he was born in Medina and he lived his entire life in Medina. To discuss about Imam Malik rahimullah, so inshallah we will first start to discuss about his great grandfather, and thereafter we will speak about his grandfather, and then we will speak about the children of his grandfather, so that is his father and his paternal uncles, and thereafter we'll inshallah speak about Imam Malik rahimullah, just so that you get a full overview of him. So starting with his great grandfather Abu Amir, he converted to Islam in the second year of the Hijri calendar, or in the year 623 CE. Although Abu Amir, so he was born in the year in the second year of Hijri, that means he was a contemporary of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But there is doubt on whether he is from the companions, whether he was a Sahabi. Some Malikis, they claim that he was actually a Sahabi and he participated in all the major battles. Alama ibn Farhun, rahimahullah, he says, ذكر القاضي بكر بن العلاء القشيري أن أبا عامر بن عمرو جد أبي مالك رحمه الله من أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And thereafter he says, وشهد المغازي كلها مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خلا بدر, because he only accepted Islam in the second year of Hijri. So basically besides Badr, all the other expeditions, all the other battles, he accompanied the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. However, there is dispute on whether this is true or not, because his name is not listed in most of the books that list the names of the companions. So when Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimullah mentions about him in Al-Isaba, you know, Al-Isaba fi tamyiz al-Sahaba, he gathers all the names of the Sahaba. So then he mentions about him Abu Amir ibn Amr ibn al-Harith ibn Ghayman, and then he says, ذَكَرَهُ الذَّهَبِي فِي التَّجْرِيدِ وَقَالَ لَمْ أَرَ مَنْ ذَكَرَهُ فِي الصَّحَابَةِ. So this is the comment that Alama ibn Hajar rahimullah passed, that Imam Zahabi rahimullah mentioned his name in al-Tajrid, but Imam Zahabi then did clarify that I haven't seen anyone who listed him amongst the Sahaba. So Alama Suyuti rahimullah, he comments on this and he says, وَنَقَلَ الْحَافِظُ ابْنُ حَجَرَ فِي الْإِصَابَةِ كَلَامَ الذَّهَبِي وَلَمْ يَزِدْهُ عَلَيْهِ. That he, Hafiz ibn Hajar just quoted the statement of Imam Zahabi and he did not pass any comment. So that signifies that Ibn Hajar rahimahullah agrees with us. And before this, Ya Alama Suyuti rahimahullah also mentioned that كَانَ فِي زَمَنِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَلَمْ يَلْقَهُ. That although he was alive in the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he did not meet the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Hence, فهو تابعي مخضرم. Such a person is called a مخضرم. A مخضرم is that person who was a Muslim in the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, but he did not meet the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. A Sahabi is that person who met the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم in a state of iman. And a مخضرم is that person who, for now, obviously, this here is just very basic. In the books of Ulum al-Hadith, there are more details to this. But it is that person who was a Muslim in that time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he did not see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So that all is with regards to his great grandfather. Coming to his grandfather, his name was Malik ibn Abi Amir. So he was definitely from the senior tabi'in. He narrated from very senior Sahaba like Umar radiyallahu anhu and Uthman radiyallahu anhu. Likewise, he also narrated from Talha radiyallahu anhu. So these are the names that Alama ibn Hibban rahimahullah mentions in his Athiqat in volume 5 on page 383. Yarwi an Umara wa Uthmana wa Talha. Alama ibn Farhun rahimahullah, he adds the names of Ali radiyallahu anhu, Aisha radiyallahu anha, Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu, and Hassan ibn Thabit. He says that يروي عن عمر وطلحة وعائشة وأبي هريرة وحسان بن ثابت رضي الله عنهم. So the grandfather of Imam Malik, he met all of these companions and he also had the privilege of getting a hadith directly from them. A great honor of his was that he was selected to assist with writing the Quran in the time of Sayyidina Uthman رضي الله عنه. So you can imagine how much regard Uthman رضي الله عنه had for him, that he could entrust him with such an important and delicate and a noble task. وروى التستري محمد بن أحمد القاضي أنه كان ممن يكتب المصاحف حين جمع عثمان رضي الله عنه المصاحف. This is in الدباج المذهب. That when عثمان رضي الله عنه was gathering all the مصاحف, then he also wrote the مصاحف. Likewise, when عثمان رضي الله عنه was assassinated, then Ali رضي الله عنه, he went out at night, you know, silently and quietly at night to retrieve the body of عثمان رضي الله عنه. So they took Malik ibn Abu Amir, the grandfather of Imam Malik رحمه الله, with them. وهو أحد الأربعة الذين حملوا عثمان رضي الله عنه ليلا إلى قبره وغسلوه ودفنوه. They quietly went and they took the blessed body of عثمان رضي الله عنه. They performed the ghusl and they buried him. So this again then illustrates how they honored and how much regard they had for the grandfather of Imam Malik rahimahullah. And it also shows how close he was to Ali radiallahu anhu, because it's obviously that for such a delicate task to go and get it quietly, that the enemies mustn't come to know, otherwise, you know, the fear of being assassinated, etc. Such a huge and enormous task. And yet, so Ali radiallahu anhu actually went out himself, and yet he had so much confidence in the grandfather of Imam Malik rahimullah that he took him with him. Malik ibn Abi Amir, he was also a very great warrior. He fought in the war that led to the conquest of North Africa. وذكر أبو محمد الضراب أن عثمان رضي الله عنه أخذاه أفريقية ففتحها. So he was delegated to invade Africa, the northern portion of Africa, and he conquered it. Ultimately, he was then given the high status of serving as an advisor for the Khalifa Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Alama ibn Farhun rahimullah, he says, وَكَانَ عُمَر ibn Abdul Aziz رضي الله عنه يستشيره, that Umar ibn Abdul Aziz would consult him. So he passed away in the year 112 Hijri. The grandfather of Imam Malik, he passed away in 112 Hijri. Now coming to the next link. So after the grandfather, we look at his children. So Malik ibn Abi Amir, he had four sons. The one is the father of Imam Malik, rahimahullah, and the other three are his paternal uncles. So these four sons of Malik ibn Abi Amir, the father of Imam Malik and his three paternal uncles, they also grew to become great scholars. Imam Malik, rahimahullah, his father was the eldest from all of them. And this here is narrated by Imam Bukhari rahimullah in Tariq al-Kabir in volume 2 on page 56. He quotes from Ismail ibn Abi Uwais, Akbar walid Malik, Anas, thumma Uwais, thumma Nafi', thumma al-Rabi'. That the eldest son, his name was Anas. So that is the father of Imam Malik. Then was Uwais, and thereafter Nafi', and then al-Rabi'. So the first son, Anas, the father of Imam Malik rahimahullah, he was a scholar in his own right. علما ابن حبان رحمه الله, he describes him من جلة المدنيين ومتقنيهم, that he was one of the most eminent and one of the most accomplished scholars in Medina. And you know, when you're talking about Medina, you're talking about Medina Munawwara at that time when it was brimming with scholars, when it was filled with the students of Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Yet the father of Imam Malik rahimahullah, he still stood out. So that shows how great he was. Imam Malik rahimahullah, he narrates one narration from his father where he narrated from his grandfather. So in the book Al-Muttafaq wal-Muftariq, Alama Khatib rahimahullah, he narrates with his sanad. The sanad links up to Yunus ibn Harun al-Azdanim. He says, عن Malik ibn Anas, عن أبيه, عن جده, عن عمر ibn al-Khattab رضي الله عنه, عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, ثلاث يفرح لهن الجسد ويربو عليه الطيب والثوب اللين وشرب العسل. So this is the narration which is being quoted where Imam Malik rahimahullah is narrating from his father, who is narrating from his grandfather. But after narrating this, Alama Khatib rahimahullah said, لا أعلم رواع مالك رحمه الله إلا من هذا الوجه. That it's only narrated in this way from Imam Malik rahimahullah. So if it's only narrated in this way, that means it's only transmitted via Yunus ibn Harun. And Yunus ibn Harun is not reliable at all. Alama ibn Hibban rahimahullah, he narrates from him. He says, Shaykhun yarwi an Malik al-ajaib. That he narrates very strange and astonishing things from Imam Malik rahimahullah. La tahillu al-riwaya anhu. Wala al-ihtijaju bihi. Bihalim min al-ahwal. He mentions this in his Al-Majruhin in volume 3 on page 140. That it's not permissible to quote him in any way. Likewise, Imam Dar Qutni rahimahullah in his book Gharaib Malik, he also said, Hadha la yasihu an Malik wa Yunus al-Da'if. That this narration where Imam Malik is narrating from his father, who's narrating from his grandfather, it's not authentic because Yunus is Da'if. So that's the father of Imam Malik rahimahullah. The next son of Imam Malik ibn Abi Amir was Uwais, so the paternal uncle of Imam Malik rahimullah. So he also narrated from his father Malik, the grandfather of Imam Malik rahimullah. Imam Bukhari rahimullah, he narrates, he mentions in Tariq al-Kabir, وَقَالَ لَنَا مُعَلَّى حَدَّثَنَا وُهَيْبٌ عَنْ مُسْعَبِ ابْنِ مُحَمَّدْ عَنْ أُوَيْسِ ابْنِ مَالِكٍ عَنْ أَبِيهِ عَنْ أُثْمَانِ فِي الْخُطْبَةِ. So here he's narrating it. Uwais ibn Malik is narrating from his father. The paternal uncle of Imam Malik is narrating from his grandfather. Alama ibn Hibban rahimullah, he adds him in his athiqat, so that signals that he is a reliable narrator. He brings his entry there. Uwais ibn Malik ibn Abi Amir al-Asbahi. It's the 6,830th entry. That's the first paternal uncle. Then the second paternal uncle, so that means the third son, he is Abu Suhail al-Asbahi Nafi' ibn Malik. So his name was Nafi'. He was also an expert in hadith. And he was a student of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhu. Alama ibn Hibban rahimullah, he mentions in his athiqat, Nafi' ibn Malik, wa huwa ammu Malik ibn Anas sami' ibn Umar. That he heard from Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhum. Likewise, he also mentions his students, that he had such great students like Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He narrated from Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. And thereafter he says that he had great students like Imam Zuhri rahimahullah. Now, you know, Imam Zuhri rahimahullah, he was amongst the six leading narrators from the junior tabi'in. So we'll inshallah discuss more about him shortly, but you can understand that this leading muhaddith, he narrated from this uncle, and he also narrated from the father of Imam Malik rahimahullah. You know, Imam Zuhri rahimahullah, he was also the first person to be given the official mandate to collect a hadith in Sir Alam al-Nubala. It's وَقَدْ رَوَى الزُّهْرِ عَنْ وَالِدِهِ أَنَسْ. It's mentioned about him. That he was the first person who Umar ibn Abdul Aziz told him that he must go around and he must go and collect a hadith. So such a great muhaddith was the student of Imam Malik's father and his uncles. In Tahzib al-Kamal, the name of Sayyidina Anas radiallahu an is also listed amongst those who Nafi' narrated from. It comes there that Rawa' an Anas ibn Malikin wa Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib wa Sahl ibn Sa'ad al-Sa'idi wa Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab wa Ali ibn al-Husayn ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib wa Umar ibn Abdul Aziz wa Awn ibn Abdullah ibn Utbah ibn Mas'ud. So from all of these great scholars, he had the opportunity of narrating from them. And besides being a great muhaddith, Alama Zahabi rahimullah also graded him as a faqih. He said, Al-Imam al-Faqih, Abu Suhail al-Asbahi, that he was a faqih. Then the last son, so that means the third paternal uncle of Imam Malik rahimullah, he was Rabi' ibn Malik ibn Abi Amir. So he was the youngest brother of Imam Malik rahimullah's father. Alama ibn Hibban rahimullah, he mentions with regards to him, يروي عن المدنيين روى عنه أهلها. The people of Medina, they narrated from him. وكان قليل الحديث. However, he narrated very few narrations, and he mentions that he passed away in the year 160 Hijri. So those are the paternal uncles and the father of Imam Malik rahimahullah. Coming to the respected mother of Imam Malik rahimahullah, Alama ibn Hibban rahimahullah mentions, wa ummu Malik al-Aliya bint Shariq ibn Abdul Rahman ibn Shariq al-Azdiyah, that the mother of Imam Malik rahimahullah, her name was Aliya, and she was the daughter of Shariq ibn Abdul Rahman. So this is mentioned by Alama ibn Hibban and Alama ibn Farhun. He also quotes this here from Alama al-Zubayr, that he al-Aliya bint Shariq, that her name was Aliya bint Shariq. However, others claim that his mother had a different name. Qala ibn Aisha, innaha Tulayha, that her name was Tulayha. Now, it is commonly known about Imam Malik rahimahullah that his mother carried him for 2 full years. So you can imagine a pregnancy of 2 years. Alama ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah, he quotes, he says, Qala ibn Bukair, وأخبرني غير عطاف أن أمه حملت به سنتين. His mother was pregnant with him for 2 years. Leave alone 2 years. Others mentioned that his mother was pregnant with him for 3 long years. That وقد ذكر غير الواقد أن أمه حملت به 3 سنين. Alama ibn Abdul Barih rahimahullah mentions this in Al-Intiqa fi Fadail al-Thalatha. He mentions that his mother carried him for 3 years. And Alama ibn Sa'ad, he actually quotes this from Imam Malik rahimullah himself. He brings, he says that أخبرنا محمد بن عمر قال سمعت مالك بن أنس يقول, that I heard Imam Malik saying قد يكون الحمل 3 سنين, that sometimes a pregnancy can be for 3 years. وقد حمل, as he mentions that there are some people who were carried in the mother's womb for 3 years. يعني نفسه, meaning he was referring to himself. So then many other scholars and historians, they also then mentioned this. So Qadi Iyad, he says, فقال ابن نافع الصائغ والواقد ومعا ومحمد بن الضحاق حملت به أمه 3 سنين. That all these great scholars, they mentioned that his mother was pregnant with him for 3 years. And then he quotes also, you know, Imam Malik rahimahullah, we'll discuss about it if we get time. He was known to be very handsome, and he was also very tall and well built. So he quotes from Bakar ibn Abdullah al-Zubayri that he said, "An dajathu wallahi ar-rahm," that because he stayed in his mother's womb for so long, for 3 years, that is how he became so, an dajathu means that he became ripe in his mother's womb. That means he grew to get this huge body and to become so handsome. So all of these are mentioned in the classical books. However, with modern science, we can now understand that this was not a pregnancy of 2 years. Rather, this is what is known as a phantom pregnancy. So the clinical term is pseudocyesis. That pseudocyesis, it refers to a false pregnancy. So this is where the female believes that she's expecting a baby when the reality is that she's not actually carrying any child. So according to the 5th edition of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, there the word pseudocyesis is mentioned, that it's an imaginary and simulated, phantom, hysterical, and spurious pregnancy. And it's mentioned that it's a rare disorder with a characteristic somatic features. So probably this year is what happened with Imam Malik rahimullah's mother. Because this year actually happens a lot, it happens very frequently in underdeveloped areas. The females, they they're unaware if they are expecting or not because they do not have any access to tests. So pseudocyesis is more frequent in rural and undeveloped countries because then the women, they are not usually examined by a physician or a midwife until they are actually in labor. So all while they are thinking that they are carrying a child, they assume that they are pregnant. But in developed countries, women have access to more accurate pregnancy tests. And they also visit gynecs, etc. So they know for sure whether they are pregnant or not. So you see, a person cannot just accept everything that he finds written. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with intellect, isn't it? So if something is impossible and it is medically and scientifically proven that you do have this kind of a rare disorder, then you cannot go around quoting it as if this year is something which was very unique, because it is not possible for a female to have such a long pregnancy. If a pregnant lady, if she didn't deliver her baby after 42 weeks of gestation, then that already is regarded as postpartum pregnancy. So the at most what you could have is 2 weeks beyond a typical 40-week duration of pregnancy. Now, already from 42 weeks, there are risks for both the parent and for the baby. That you have risks such as fetal malnutrition and meconium aspiration syndrome, and also the child could be a stillborn. So after the 42nd week of gestation, the placenta, and that's what supplies the baby with nutrients and oxygen from the parent, that starts to age, and that will eventually then fail. And this is the reason why they induced labor, because the chances of the baby surviving becomes much less. So a study from Scotland that was published in 2010 demonstrated an increased risk of a stillbirth. So both overall and unexplained stillbirth, because when pregnancy advances, especially after 39 weeks of gestation. So yes, we don't disagree that there are pregnancies that are longer than 40 weeks and 42 weeks and the babies do survive. But this year is very, very rare and it is unusual. The longest recorded pregnancy was 375 days. So according to a 1945 entry in the Time magazine, a woman whose name is Bula Hunter, she gave birth in Los Angeles nearly 100 days after the average 280-day pregnancy. So that's half of what is being attributed to Imam Malik Rahmullah's mother. So if something so unusual was really true, then it would have been the talk of the town. It would have reached us through tawatur. It would have been well documented. It would be that Imam Malik Rahmullah's mother had the longest ever known pregnancy. But in contrast to this year, we find that there are differences of opinion. So therefore, we say that this year was actually, it was not a full pregnancy. And then, yes, you do have the statements in fiqh books under the chapters of talaq and tubutun nasab regarding the maximum pregnancy being 2 years. But that will be reviewed by a mufti or a qadi. If ever a woman does have a pregnancy for that long duration and the baby survives, then the mufti can then discuss whether you're going to now look at modern science or whether you're going to follow what's mentioned in all the fiqh books. But that's not within the scope of discussion here. So basically what we are trying to say, that Imam Malik rahimahullah, he was not in the stomach of his mother for 2 or 3 years. As for his date of birth, there is much difference of opinion. Alama Qurtubi rahimahullah, he said, اختلف في مولده رحمه الله تعالى اختلافا كثيرا. There are lots of differences of opinion regarding the birth, the date of birth of Imam Malik rahimahullah. So the one view is that he was born in the year 93 AH. Alama Ibn Abd al-Barr rahimahullah, he quotes with his sonnet to Yahya ibn Bukair that he said, ولد مالك ابن أنس 93 من الهجرة. He mentioned this in Al-Intiqa, that Imam Malik rahimahullah was born in the year 93 after Hijri. Qadi Iyadha rahimahullah, he mentions that this is the most popular opinion. Fal ashhar fi ma ruwiya min dhalika qawl Yahya ibn Bukair anna mawlida usana 93 min al-Hijra. That this year is the more popular opinion that he was born in the year 93 during the Khilafat of Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. And Alama Zahabi rahimahullah, he also authenticated this view. Mawlid Malik ala al-asah في سنة 93 عام موت أنس خادم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And قاضي عيازي also quotes from Imam Abu Dawud رحم الله. That Imam Abu Dawud رحم الله said, وقال أبو داود السجستاني سنة 93. That Imam Malik رحم الله was born in the year 93 هجري. However, علماء ابن عبد البر رحم الله, he then quotes, he says, وقال عمارة بن وثيمة ولد مالك بن أنس في ربيع الأول سنة 94. So now he's mentioning a different view. He's mentioning that he was born in the year 94 هجري. And in ترتيب المدارك قاضي عياض رحمه الله, he quotes the same from another scholar. وروي عن محمد بن عبد الحكم أن مولده سنة 94. That he was born in the year 94 هجري. Then there's still another view. قاضي عياض رحمه الله, he quotes another scholar. claiming that Imam Malik rahimahullah was born in the year 95 Hijri. وقال أبو إسحاق الشيرازي سنة 95 that he was born in the year 95 Hijri. Another view is that he was born in the year 97 Hijri. علامة ابن عبد البر رحمه الله says وغير هؤلاء يقولون ولد مالك بن أنس سنة 97 من الهجرة. That others say that he was born in the year 97 Hijri. So it is normal to have these types of differences on a person's date of birth and his date of demise, simply because there were no birth certificates, there were no identity documents in those days. So the date of birth was not recorded, it was just an estimate. And even today, when you go to many rural areas, you will find, so when we went to Morocco also, there we are, one of the shuyukh who we read the Muwaṭṭa to, inshallah, when we mention about him, when we speak about the ijāzāt, his students, they mention an extremely different age. And when he passed away, then it was found that he was only 105 years old. So that shows that even today, it is just estimate. Also like that, when you go in Jamaat to India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, you go to all those rural areas, you ask them the age, they say taqariban, like approximately. Why? Because they don't have any birth documents. So Alama Kawthari rahimahullah, he also highlights that this year was all long before the books of wafiyat were written. So therefore you will also have differences on the dates of demise. So Alama Kawthari rahimahullah, he explains that this is how it's because of this year that you didn't have books of wafiyat, etc. So this is the reason why there's so much differences of opinion on the dates of birth and the dates of demise. And then he said that if you look at the very famous Sahabi, Ubay ibn Ka'b, he was so famous, yet there are so many differences regarding his date of demise. So then Alama Kawthari rahimahullah, he explains an interesting principle when you need to determine whether the chain will be muttasil or munqati'. Because if a person is born in the year 97, for example, and he's mentioning that he heard from someone who passed away in the year 90, then you know there's inqita' in the sanad, isn't it? Because he was only born after that person passed away. So there's definitely a missing link. So how would you know whether a sanad is muttasil when you have so many different views regarding a person's date of birth and the date of demise? So he says, وَعِنْدَ تَعَدُّرِ الْأَقْوَالِ وَالرِّوَايَاتِ فِي الْوِلَادَةِ أَوِ الْوَفَاةِ يُؤْخَذُ بِالْقَوْلِ الْمُتَأَخَّرِ فِي الْوِلَادَةِ. That for birth, you take the latest day. This is when you don't have any proof. Now, because Alama Zahabi, rahmallah, and them, they're all authenticating the year 93. So that is why we're taking, and we're mentioning that Imam Malik was actually born in the year 93. But when you don't have any qarina, or you don't have any reason, or you don't have any proof to show exactly which date, then for the date of birth, you work on the latest date. So if there's multiple views, you take the latest date. So it makes sense, because then if he's mentioning that he quoted from someone earlier, you know, the closer you are to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's a greater privilege. You could get a hadith directly from the Sahaba if you are born early, or else you could get directly from the Tabi'in. So the later you go, the more you lose this privilege. So therefore, you take the latest date for the birth, and you take the earliest date for wafat, because for wafat, for the date when a person passed away, others are going to be mentioning that they quoted from him or they heard from him. So say, for example, it's mentioned about a person. Some say that he was born, he passed away in 130. Others say 131, others say 132, others say 133. So if you take the earliest date, it will be 130. If a person was only born in the year 123 Hijri, in the year 130, he will only be 7 years old. So you can say that he couldn't have narrated from this person, or he couldn't have made proper tahammul from this person. But if it's 133, then there's more chances that you could accept that you could accept that narration that he's quoting from that person. So this here is just a small principle which I mentioned in passing. But Imam Malik rahimahullah, the preferred view is that he was born in the year 93 Hijri, and he was from the Atba'u Tabi'in. Now, with regards to his physical appearance, we mentioned that he was described as being very fair, and also that he had blue eyes. And this here is something which was uncommon in Medina. So therefore, he also got the title Ashqar. Ashqar, it means the person who's extremely fair in complexion. And he was also very handsome. That Abu Asim says, مَا رَأَيْتُ مُحَدِّثًا أَحْسَنْ وَجْهًا مِنْ مَالِكِ. I haven't seen anyone who was more handsome than Imam Malik, rahimahullah. In Isa ibn Umar al-Madini, he says, مَا رَأَيْتُ قَطُّ بَيَاضًا وَلَا حُمْرَةً أَحْسَنُ مِنْ وَجْهِ مَالِكٍ وَلَا أَشَدْ بَيَاضْ ثَوْبِهِ مِنْهُ. I haven't seen the mixture of redness and whiteness more better than the face of Imam Malik rahimahullah. Likewise, others like Mutarrif and Ismail and even Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, they all gave given descriptions of Imam Malik rahimahullah. بعضهم يزيدوا على بعض. Some have given more descriptions, others have described him in less detail. So they mentioned that كان طويلا جسيما عظيم الهامة, that he was extremely tall, he was of large stature, he was well built. أبيض الرأس واللحية, his beard and the color of his hair started to change when he was still young. So if any of you is young and you're starting to get white hairs, don't stress, this year is like Imam Malik rahimahullah. And then also they mentioned that Hassan al-Sura, that he was extremely handsome. Asla, that he started to become bald also when he was still young. And this is also from Umar radiallahu anhu, that he also started to become bald when he was young, and he also started to turn white when he was young. And the both of them, Imam Malik and Umar radiallahu anhu, they both refused to dye their hair. They preferred to have white hair in spite of being young. And it's mentioned that he had a full beard, عظيم اللحية تامها تبلغ صدره ذات سعة وطول. A very huge beard he had, and the size of his mustache, he would keep that, he would not trim that. And when he was bored, he would also play with the size of his mustache. إذا همه الأمر, when he was bored, or sometimes when he was worried, then he would play with the size of his mustache. Likewise, Mus'ab al-Zubayri, he said, كان مالك بن أنس من أحسن الناس وجها, that he was the most handsome, وأحلاهم عينا وأنقاهم بياضا وأتمهم طولا في جودته برن. And that is why they say that because he was for 3 years in his mother's womb, and ضجته والله الرحم, that maybe because of that he got such a huge body. Also, one thing is mentioned about his ears, that وكان في أذنيه كبرة كأنهما كفى إنسان أو دون ذلك, that his ears were so large, it was as if they were the palm of a human being. So large ears he had. With regards to the children of Imam Malik rahimahullah, so Imam Malik rahimahullah, he had 2 sons and he had a daughter. The sons were Yahya and Muhammad, and his daughter's name was Fatima. So both of his sons, they narrated from him. Ibn Shu'ban, he says, وَيَحْيَ ibn Malik يَرْوِي عَنْ أَبِيهِ نُسْخَةً, that he narrates from his father a nuskha of the Muwaṭṭa. And it's also mentioned, وَذُكِرَ أَنَّهُ تُرْوَى عَنْهُ بِالْيَمَنِ. In Yemen, they narrate by the son of Yahya. So from Yahya, they narrate the Muwaṭṭa from Yahya ibn Malik, from his son Yahya. Likewise, وَرَوَى عَنْهُ مُحَمَّدُ ibn Maslama. And وَابْنُ مُحَمَّدْ قَدِمَ مِصر. His other son, Muhammad, he came to Egypt. And there the Egyptians, they started to hear the Muwaṭṭa from that son of his. So this here proves that both of his sons, they narrated the Muwaṭṭa from him. However, they did not excel in ilm as much as Imam Malik rahimahullah would have loved. So it's mentioned that once Imam Malik rahimahullah, Musa ibn Abi Alqama, he says that we were with Imam Malik rahimahullah, and his son Yahya came in, and he just came in, yadkhul wa yakhruj wa la yajlis. He came in and then he departed. He didn't sit. So Imam Malik rahimahullah turned to us and he said, that the greatest thing, the greatest regret I have is that أَنَّ هَذَا الشَّأْن لَا يُورَث, that this ilm is something which does not pass down as inheritance, because now I can't give it like to my son. He doesn't want to take it from me, and it can't be passed on to him for free. Like, you know, inheritance, how the wealth is just passed on for free. Likewise, his other son, Muhammad, once he did not display much respect to the ahadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Imam Malik rahimahullah, he commented on the respect of the son and he compared it to that of his daughter. وَكَانَ ابْنُ مُحَمَّدْ يَجِيهُ وَيُحَدِّثْ وَعَلَى يَدِي بَاشِتْ. So he came there with his pet bird, and he was like, you know, in a very untidy manner. فَيَلْتَفِتُ مَالِكِ إِلَىٰ أَصْحَابِهِ وَيَقُولْ إِنَّمَا الْأَدَبْ أَدَبُ اللَّهِ, that adab is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هَذَا بْنِي وَهَذِي بِنْتِي. Look, this here is my son and this is my daughter. Both got the same upbringing. But this son of mine, he comes in such a casual way to the dars of hadith. Well, inshallah, I don't think maybe today, maybe tomorrow we'll discuss about the respect that Imam Malik rahimahullah had for a hadith. So She's mentioning that the both of them have the same upbringing, but my daughter, she has so much respect, and my son, he has no respect. So this daughter of his was outstanding, Fatima bint Malik. She was extremely knowledgeable. Zubair, he says, كَانَ لِمَالِكْ إِبْنَةٌ تَحْفَظُ عِلْمَهُ يَعْنِي الْمُوَطَّةِ, that his daughter memorized the entire Muwaṭṭa. وَكَانَتْ تَقِفُ خَلْفَ الْبَابِ, that she would stand behind the bab. So it's not even mentioned sitara. It's not even mentioned that a curtain, rather it's a wooden door. She would stand behind the door. فَإِذَا غَلَطَ الْقَارِئُ نَقَرَتِ الْبَابِ, when the person reading to Imam Malik rahmullah would make a mistake, she would knock on the door with her finger, with her nails. So then Imam Malik rahmullah would become alert, and Imam Malik rahmullah would correct the mistake. So from this here, we also understand that, you know, many times people talk about female narrators of hadith, but you can see that it's not that they would just come in open and in front of all the males and narrate. Yeah, she actually stood behind the door, and also she didn't mention anything verbally. She could have mentioned it. We just said now that tahfadu ilmahu, she knew it all of her heart, and that is how she's recognizing that it was a mistake. But rather, with her fingertip, she made a sound on the door, and that is how Imam Malik rahimahullah. So you can see the level of haya, and these are important points to keep in mind when trying to use all these as evidence to prove that females must come out and they must start to narrate and give public lectures, etc. These are important, and it's all established from authentic asanid. And then from this son Muhammad, Imam Malik rahimahullah, he had a grandson. And this grandson, he also grew up to become a scholar. وَكَانَ لِمُحَمَّدْ هَذَا إِبْنٌ إِسْمُهُ أَحْمَدٌ, so his name was Ahmad. So Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Malik. سَمِعَ مِنْ جَدِّهِ Malik. He heard from his grandfather, Imam Malik rahimahullah. And he passed away in the year 256 Hijri. And you know, Imam Bukhari rahimahullah, he also passed away in the year 256 Hijri. With regards to seeking of knowledge, so Imam Malik rahimahullah, in the very initial stages, he did not have enough funds. So, but he had the thirst for knowledge. So now he needed to get funds to pay for and to go and attain knowledge. So what did he do? He dismantled the roof of his house and he sold the wood to gain enough wealth to pay for his studies. Ibn al-Qasim, he says, أفضى بمالك طلب العلم إلى أن نقض سقف بيته فباع خشبه ثم مالت عليه الدنيا بعد. Yes, after that, his wealth, then he became extremely wealthy. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then opened the doors of rizq for him. And you know, this year is one of the benefits, the side benefits of studying the Muwatta, that throughout time, it has always been proven that teachers and students of the Muwatta, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala generally make them very financially stable and extremely wealthy. That when you look at some of the narrators, when you read about them, you will find of how the person came in and he thought that he was entering the palace of the king, and he was orchard first and so many gardeners and then slaves, and then he came to the huge palace. So every so most of the narrators of the Muwatta throughout time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make them extremely wealthy, because scholars, they took a good omen from the name of Imam Malik rahimahullah. But remember that this year is just a side benefit, and it shouldn't be the primary objective of why we are studying. So Hazrat Abdul Hamid, he mentions that a person, if he intends and his objective is to get all these secondary benefits, then it's like a person who buys a cow for manure. So, you know, you buy the cow just so that you can, your grass can grow, so for manure. So instead of buying it for the fresh milk and so many other benefits of the cow. So like that, we study a hadith only and only for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if our intention becomes, because now when we come to know about all of this, if our intent, if we get ulterior motives, then we could even risk our entry into Jannah. So basically there are two great benefits of studying the Muwatta. This year is when studying the lives of all the narrators. The first is that those who study and narrate the Muwatta, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala generally blesses them with long lives. And that is how that even though we are now 1400 years, we are so late. But from us to Imam Malik rahimahullah, or maybe say 1300 years, because taking the age of Imam Malik, there's only about 14 or 15 narrators in between, because all of them Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed them with long lives. So in Morocco, when we went, we heard from four different shuyukh, all of them lived for more than 100 years. And their teachers in turn all left for more than 100 years. And so like this year, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses a person with long life, and a person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses the person with abundant wealth. These are two benefits for studying the Muwaṭṭa. And then for memorizing the Muwaṭṭa, and alhamdulillah, in our Muwaṭṭa course, we have many of our ulama who are both males and females, the mulanas and appas, who are memorizing the Muwaṭṭa. Make dua, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make it easy for them. The benefit of memorizing the Muwaṭṭa, Imam Malik rahimahullah, he said that whenever I slept, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in my dream. This great virtue is passed on to any person who memorizes the Muwaṭṭa. Throughout time, they found that whenever a person memorizes the Muwaṭṭa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses him with the opportunity of seeing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam whenever he falls asleep. Inshallah, we'll continue from here tomorrow. And tomorrow's lesson will also be for 1 hour. Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.